Hi and assalamualaikum everyone. Welcome to my presentation. My name is Nurmanisha binti Abdul Majid, matrix number 139181, and my supervisor is Prof. Dr. Zari Shariman Yahya. Today I would like to present to you about my Viva, that is Prevalence of Gastrointestinal Parasite of Goats in Penang, Malaysia. These are my thesis outline for the presentation. Let's go to the first part of the presentation, which is the introduction part. Asia is home to 56% of the world's goat population of roughly 1 billion. Most of the gross national income comes from the goat farming. However, goat production is severely hampered by gastrointestinal parasite infection, which has caused a major economic loss in goat industry. The problem statement. According to Hashim and Yusuf 2016, the humid, wet and tropical climate in Malaysia throughout the year is favorable for the growth of gastrointestinal parasite, which has caused a high prevalence of gastrointestinal parasite infection in goats. As said by Das et al. 2017, this issue has resulted in poor growth rate, diarrhea, dysentery and anemia, and supposed to be one of the economically most important disease of goats. The primary objective of this study is to determine the prevalence of gastrointestinal parasites infecting smallholder goat farm around Penang. This study also suggests several research objectives to be attained, which are the first one, to determine the mean EPG reading for the farm fecal samples of goats, and the second one is to identify the main species of gastrointestinal parasites infecting goats. Let's go to the literature review part. Malaysia's meat demand rose to 2 million tonnes in 2018, exceeding the country's meat supply of 400,000 tonnes that year, which predicts that demand will rise annually. Malaysia's need for high-quality animal protein is anticipated to rise as the country's population grows, urbanization develops, and the country's affluence grows. Some of the goats breed are Anglo-Nubian, Jamnapari, Boer, Savannah, Kalahari Red, the Kajang goat, and crossbreeds. According to Das et al. 2017, parasitic infection of gastrointestinal parasite are often reported in goats, which cause significant economic loss on livestock production as a result of dead and decreased weight growth in the affected animals. As shown in the screen, these are the common life cycle of wool. These are the common species of gastrointestinal parasite infecting goats, which include Trichostrongylus species, Esophagostomum species, Hemminkan species, and Coporia species. Let's go through the methodology part. First is sampling. This study was conducted from December 2020 to April 2021 in three selected goat farms. These goat farms were located in three different districts of Pulau Pinang, which were Bukit Mertajam, Gelugur and Teluk Kumbar. A total of 270 goat fecal samples comprising 9 goat batches, mainly Kacang and Boer breed, were randomly collected in these three farms in Pulau Pinang. Next is lab test. First is the McMaster technique. This method was conducted to determine the number of parasite eggs per gram of feces. The next lab test is the fecal culture method. This was conducted to identify the third stage larvae, the L3 of the parasite. Then, based on the data obtained, statistical analysis were performed for the differences in average fecal egg count, the FEC, and L3 stage count for all the farms selected using one-way ANOVA. Continuing with the first lab test conducted, the McMaster technique. 3 grams of fecal samples were weighed and placed in a jar containing saturated salt solution. Then, the mixture was poured in a mortar and ground into a paste using a pestle. After that, the mixture was filtered using a tea sieve and the liquid was poured in a clean jar. After that, a pipette was placed in the center of the jar to the center of overall depth to pipette out the sediment. The boat counting chambers of the McMaster slide were filled. And then the slide was observed under a microscope under 10x10 magnification. The next method, the fecal culture. It starts by crushing off the fecal sample using a mortar and pestle and mixing them with distilled water. The mixture will pour into half cup of a culture jar and wipe clean. Then the jar was kept loosely and left for a week to incubate at room temperature for 7 days. During the 7 days of culture, the mixture was added with distilled water regularly to keep the mixture moist. After a week, the distilled water was added and the opening of the culture jar was closed with a petri dish and turned upside down. Using a pipette, the larvae was collected from the fecal culture and placed on a slide and covered with a cover slip. After that, the larvae was observed under a microscope at 40 times magnification. For the identification of parasite, each parasite found was identified based on the morphology of its head and tail. Here, as you can see on the screen, I refer to a handout provided by my supervisor for its morphology. The next thing we'll see is the result part. In this study, no FEC readings were recorded for the fecal sample collected. Therefore, the prevalence of gastrointestinal parasite of goats was obtained from the culture method based on the infective L3 stage count. Out of 9 goat patches, 6 goat patches were infected with gastrointestinal parasite, which gives a percentage of 67% infected. Based on the L3 count, all of the 9 batches of goats from Sungai Dua Glugo Farm were infected, which reported the highest prevalence of infection with a percentage of 100%, followed by Teluk Kumbar Bayan Lepas Farm, 44%, and the lowest prevalence was reported in Curug Tokun Bukit Mertajam with a percentage 33%. Each farm recorded 3 times sampling. Thus, based on the data obtained, this graph was obtained. The mean of L3 count was the highest in Sungai Dua Glugo Farm, followed by Teluk Kumbar Bayan Lepas Farm, and the least was in Curug Tokun Bukit Mertajam Farm. The differences and severity of the prevalence recorded in these 3 sampling sites will be further discussed in the discussion part. As for the identification of infective L3 stage, 2 species of gastrointestinal parasite were identified in this study, which were Esophagostomum species and Trichostrongylus species. The prevalence are 44% for Esophagostomum and 56% for Trichostrongylus. Based on the statistical analysis performed, the p-value obtained was 0.43. This concludes that there were no statistically significant differences between the mean value of the infective L3 stage count for all the farms observed. These are some of the reasons for the no FEC values recorded for the fecal sample collected. This issue might develop due to the presence of systematic errors including incorrect measurement tool calibration, poorly maintained instruments, or incorrect measurement reading, which might occur during weighing the fecal sample using the weighing scale or during preparing the saturated salt solution, which is the sodium chloride solution. Besides that, due to the COVID-19 pandemic, the sample size was small, leading to lower chance of obtaining positive results. In addition, the parasite eggs was often mistaken for debris and bubbles because of the lack of the technical skill and experience to identify and count gastrointestinal parasite eggs of different species from the fecal sample collected. The severity of gastrointestinal parasite infection in this study depends on several factors, that is, deworming practice, management practice, and climatic condition in these farms. First, we'll go through the climatic condition. As reported by Chia and Rajamanikam 1997, due to the high temperatures in Malaysia, the survival of infective larvae on the pasture is shorter than in temperate countries, which enhance the metabolic rates of the larvae. Moreover, during the rainy season, grazing animals are more susceptible to parasite infections. The second one is management practice. During the study, the farmer had poor farm management, such as non-hygienic pens, which could contaminate the environment where the animals would feed on it and become reinfected. The large herd size and compact environment could also promote the intensity of parasitic housing. Overcrowding also can increase the chances of goats coming into direct contact with each other. The last one is deworming practice. All of the farm had not kept proper deworming record for controlling gastrointestinal parasite for the past 1 year. As reported by Chandrawatani et al. 1999, antimetic resistance is rapidly increasing in parasite of small ruminant in Malaysia due to the frequent and indiscriminate use of antimetics. Now, why don't we continue with a look at the control strategies. By implementing integrated parasite management, IPM, this parasite's infection can be controlled effectively. In this aspect, maintaining a high stock rate together with a proper antimetic treatment are essential. Ensuring the deworming effectiveness, use of herbal remedies as an alternative to treat parasitic infection, and by applying rotational grazing where goats will be moved from one paddock to another. As for the conclusion, control strategies must be implemented in a timely manner to help reduce the infection of gastrointestinal parasite among ruminants. Here, I would suggest for further research in order to come up with a proper identification of the gastrointestinal parasites infecting goats. These are the references that I have used in this presentation. And that's all from me. Thank you.